Hi, I'm Nick, and I like comics.
And I'm Adam, and I know comics.
Welcome to another episode of Adam and Nick Spoil Some Comics, where we spoil some comics. Today, we are talking about all-new X-Men number 5 with the creative team of Dennis Hopeless and Mark Bagley.
So the issue kicks off right where we left off in Paris, France, with Blob having completely obliterated She-Wolverine, or Wolverine, however you want to put it, into the ground till her head is completely splat. Angel, at this point, is very upset, reasonably so, because his girlfriend was just turned to splat. And although she could probably come back from it, that's still got to be pretty gut-wrenching.
Right, right. I mean, I know that he knows her powers, but it's probably one of those things of where he kind of forgets her powers because she's a pile of mush.
Right. So Blob asks him to show off what he's got. He shows that he can turn his wings into gigantic more fiery wings, I guess. But decides instead to run over to Wolverine, Laura, to see if he can do anything to help. And instead, he just looks at her and goes, "Wow, you're totally dead."
Yeah.
And he's upset by it, but he's like, anybody else would be mortified even more so. Maybe, but she doesn't die as easily as the rest because she's the Wolverine.
Are we ever going to get used to calling her Wolverine?
It's really hard. Yeah. It's not easy. So the scene changes over to Beast, probably dealing with Twitter on a tablet right now. He's like, "You track the right words, and it's all right here. Time, place, location, crowdsourced news feeds from all over the world in real time, no less." And he says, "Man, it's equal parts fascinating and unsettling. Natural, I suppose, to be wrestling with feelings of scientific inadequacy in a future that now seems to have passed me by." Poor Beast, left behind the times. And then Blob punches him in the face.
Yeah. And I know that Blob is an over-exaggerated kind of character, mm-hmm. but his fist is like as big as Beast is from, like, the chest up.
Right.
It's massive.
Blob then says, "Will you teeny bobber X-Men just let me bleeping eat?" And now he's still swinging. He's swinging around his meal from the last, which I don't know what kind of monster animal this is.
It's a spider wolf. That's what I said. It's a spider wolf.
Spider wolf. Okay.
A giant spider wolf.
Instead of a wolf spider.
Sure.
The scene changes over to Notre Dame de Paris, which is that giant cathedral in Paris, where Heidi has come to deal out her issues with God, I guess. As she walks in, they have this nice little thing where the candles all turn to ice as she walks by. And she's upset. She wants to talk to God.
And she says, "We need to talk," like yelling at him.
Right.
She's not happy.
Scene switches back now over to Cyclops, who's at some sort of vendor touristy stand where there's a couple cute girls he's flirting with. And he's talking about how soccer's gotten a lot more popular than since when he was a kid in the U.S. But that was like
1964.
Right. So not, you know, that's that Marvel time thing again. He isn't spending $30 on a soccer ball, which is, you know, a bit too much probably, but he's trying to convince these girls that he's, you know, he can throw it around. Maybe he's just trying to be cool.
Mm-hmm.
He accidentally trips and knocks his soccer ball down an alley, and he sighs and goes after it, and it gets thrown back to him with the engraving "Let's Play" on it. And when he questions who's in there, we see eyes with a couple warts around the eyes. We have some ideas of who it might be. We'll let you figure out for yourself. And he says, "Come and see." Before anything happens with that, Blob comes busting through a brick wall, dragging along Beast and the spider
wolf. Yeah.
As they keep going, and Cyclops moves straight into military mode, calling after Hank and gazatting at them.
Yeah, I really like the action words. Is that a good word for it? You know, kazat!
Onomatopoeias?
Like, sure. There you go. Is that real?
I think that's what it is.
Okay. Anyway, Kazat is a good one. I like it.
It is a good one.
Angel then walks over to Wolverine's body, and then we start hearing these sounds. Snap, thock, slurp. And it's her body, like, you know, coming back together, her head reforming. And you know, and there's this great panel of Angel turning and going, "Hork!" And just, like, puking all over the ground as Wolverine is coming back to life with a ka-clunk.
The scene transitions over to a shoe store where Kid Pocalypse and Iceman are shopping, and Iceman's apparently flirting with the boy at the counter, still kind of new to that, you know, just letting him be himself. And Pocalypse is like, "Hey man, you think you've got to work tonight? Work. But I'm on your team. I'll cover for you. Whatever happens tonight, you're good. You can hang out with this guy." And Bobby gets his number, but then he bails quickly in kind of a nervous getaway to go buy some street crepes. Anything to get away, I guess.
Is that like street cred?
No, it's like street pancakes. Like, okay.
Yeah, I was trying to make a joke, Adam.
Not a good joke.
Okay.
Kidpocalypse asks him, "What's that about the freak out just a minute ago? Do you want to talk about it?" He says, "I have no desire whatsoever." And Apocalypse says, "Listen, man, you know, Bobby, I was cloned from a more or less immortal fascist god king whose genocide obsession runs so deep he renamed himself Apocalypse. And that fact never comes up. The X-Men accepted me for who I am right from the start. Do you really think I'm judging you for flirting with a guy? And Bobby's response is, I honestly don't really know you. I just thought you were that smiley guy who stood in the corner and didn't say much. They move conversation to asking about maybe how does Hank feel about this? And
in the very first issue, they went to go get pizza. Mm-hmm. And Hank was like, hey, Bobby, you know, I'm here if you want to talk to me. Letting us, the readers, know that he's okay with Bobby being gay. But then Bobby's like, dude, I don't want to talk about it. Like, leave me alone. I don't want to talk about it.
Right. So we know that Hank is his kind of a big brother of sorts. And Bobby feels like he doesn't want to put his mess into, you know, Hank's realm of responsibilities. And so as they're trying to kind of move conversation along, they're like, well, it's kind of scary that the old Iceman never really said anything to anybody. That's kind of sad. Before they can really complete the conversation, we see a complete cluster of mess with a police motorcycle cop getting thrown through the air while Cyclops accidentally shoots him. And then Blob is throwing his spider wolf around as a weapon now. And Beast is getting thrown through the... It's a whole mess. So bad timing. They join the fight. Now it goes back to the church again. So back at the cathedral, Idy is just yelling at God about how it's not fair that he's supposed to be all good and love and kindness, but he's also this vengeful, righteous God that wants justice. And how does she fit into this? She was taught that mutants are demons made flesh. They're demons manifest, basically, and that they're supposed to be these evil things. But she's like, I'm not evil, and my friends aren't evil. Why are we demonized by certain people in the church? It's really frustrating. And she says, I don't hate myself anymore, and things have kind of changed. So she asks this really great question. Can I hold on to the loving God who taught me how to be good and pretend the vengeful jerk doesn't exist? Or does it really have to be all or nothing? She says, you should think on this and get back to me because Iceman just flew through the window and apparently there's a problem I gotta take care of outside. So the fight continues on outside where now there's police copters and absolute destruction while Blob is just complete rage mode now, just rah, and slamming a light post.
He's very hangry. He just wants to eat.
Just wants to eat. Yeah. He's knocked over a whole double-decker city bus and everything else. Back over with Wolverine coming back to life at this point. She's like, what happened? The Blob happened. Okay, I guess I played that sloppy. I didn't do right. I'm going to try again. Where did he go? And Angel says, well, he left right after he killed you. And she shrugs and laughs and like, oh, nobody killed me. Which way did he go? And Angel just responds, I can't do this anymore. We're breaking up. That's how the issue ends. Classic teen drama style.
This was an enjoyable issue, but I will say it seemed to be really disjointed and kind of all over the place. And really the thing that actually tied this whole issue together was the Blob. You know, him just like running through town, I'm hungry, I want to eat, and along the way I'm going to beat up all these X-Men, you know, just because they're in my way. I'm kind of confused about the Blob here, just I don't know how he's strong and has these powers, because he was depowered on M-Day, and then he was actually in Genosha and buying the MGH, you know, so he could inject himself so he would get his powers back. So, I don't know, maybe he's on, like...
Roid rage right
now? Roid rage, but, like, you know, mutant growth hormone, whatever that may be. So, just a side note, you know, kind of confused about that. But overall, you know, I enjoyed it. I think one of the things... A problem with a big cast story in a big cast comic is you have all these characters and trying to get them their limelight and, you know, trying to get them, you know, in. Here we are on the fifth issue, and this is really the first time that we get to see Apocalypse and Idy as characters in it.
Right.
You know, and it's taken us five issues to get there. And the first three really focused a lot on Cyclops. Mm-hmm. And so it's... I wish there was more of that, but I understand, you know, you have a big cast, so you kind of have to do stuff like this, where you have this story where they're in all these different parts and they get all pulled in together, so I get that. I find Idy's conversation with God very interesting. I like it that we have a comic dealing with stuff like this, because these are real life questions that real life people have, you know, blaming God, being frustrated with God, wanting to talk to God, and they feel they have a good relationship with God, but they don't think God has a relationship with them or whatever that may be. And I like here someone is exploring that a little bit. I think that's pretty interesting. And then, you know, the stuff with Bobby is... Just seeing that play out is interesting to me as well. So with that, I think I will give this issue a 3.5 out of 5 yellow X-Men symbols. And the reason for the lower rating for me, like we said, is it feels just a little disjointed instead of like a cohesive thing, I guess I would say. Also, from the first panel of issue 4, whenever I saw this little interchange between Angel and Wolverine, I knew they were going to break up. I mean, doesn't take a genius to see where they were going with that. So, at least he let her get all healed before he dumped her.
Yeah, that was nice. I really like how in this comic, the issues that they deal with are very poignant for teenagers especially. They're all questions that people ask themselves throughout their lives anyway, but definitely like teenager problems there. So you've got the guy, of course, who's gay and dealing with that when he's now a little bit less realistic here. Out of place, displaced from out of time, you know, from a time where that wasn't necessarily as accepted and now it is, and he's dealing with that. It's kind of interesting to see how it's going to play out. Most of his fears just come from the fact that the older version of himself still keeps that bottled up and doesn't talk about it with anybody and has just kept it, like, in the closet, pressured down for such a long time, and that scares him. But it's also very interesting to see Idy, like, not just have a conversation, but just full-out yell at God about all this frustration and how she feels like she is what's evil, but she's trying to get over that because she's not evil. And it's that debate that a lot of teenagers, I think, have about, you know, is what I'm doing right in the eyes of God? And that's a very interesting conversation to have with herself and this, it really, realistically, a statue of the cross anyway. But the way it's very disjointed, it's both good and bad. I like that they can kind of be a little bit less safe in their storytelling style, and then it still works out to be a great comic. But it does make it kind of tough to read when you're like, where is all this? I mean, it's just flipping back and forth, like, oh, we're in this scene, now we're in this scene, and we're back and forth a lot. So that's a little bit confusing, but it works out. I wish I could see a little bit more Cyclops because we've had so much Cyclops so far. It kind of made him seem like the main focus, and now he's just like 3 pages of this one. So that's trying to give everybody else part of the limelight, but also makes that disjointed nature kind of expand to the series so far, not just the one issue. But that being said, overall, writing's still solid. Great conversations between teenagers. That's like, it sounds like teenagers talking with each other, despite the fact they're also fighting a giant fat dude. And the art's still, it's selling it. So I would also give this one a 3.5 out of 5 red X symbols, which means that for once, Nick and I actually have the same rating on something, which is very interesting. But that just means that I think we're either now agreeing more, or maybe that this issue is just like that perfect zone where it gets us both the same. I don't know. But it's a good issue.
Let's talk about this mysterious figure just really quick. We saw his eyes and, you know, with this Let's Play. And if you look at the picture, it kind of looks, it's a blue hue, and it kind of looks feline a little bit, you know, or your cat or something. But then there's those warts. And so we were talking about it, and we were trying to, you know, is this maybe Nightcrawler because of the blue, or maybe Beast, you know? In the Battle for the Atom storyline, we had these future versions, you know, come back, and there was old Beast, who was actually this now supervillain. So maybe it was them, but we think that it's actually Toad, who we saw at the end of issue number 3 freak out in this bar whenever he saw Cyclops on the screen. So that's our thought.
Yeah, I think it's Toad because he's got the warts, and the blue hue also extends to Cyclops on the same page.
He's in a dark, alley, you know, where darker is typically cast as blue.
And so we assume that Toad is just following them right now, waiting and biding his time.
Probably following them on Twitter.
Probably. I mean, if Beast is like completely unreined on how to use Twitter, and he's just basically an old man now given Twitter, essentially, you know. Oh, gosh.
Thank you again for watching our spoiler cast on All New X-Men number 5. We are thoroughly enjoying this title, so please comment below and let us know what you think about All New X-Men. Is this your favorite X-book right now? Is it uncanny? Is it extraordinary? You know, what are some of your favorite X-books, or what are some of your favorite comics that you are reading right now?
So like the video, subscribe to our channel, and don't forget to follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. And until next time, we're going to keep reading more comic books. Lots and lots of comic books.
Lots of them.
Never-ending comic.